we have heard many speakers in the morning session talk, there were many aspects of our human history, Homo erectus, and so on. But as a species today, we really are not quite Homo sapiens. We have virtually become Homo scientificus. Every aspect of modern life, whether it is to do with is to do with either science or technology, whether it is human health, our housing, transportation, especially communication in this day and age. Every aspect of human life is touched by science in one way or the other. And yet, there is a bit of a divide. There is a divide between those who do science and those who see the benefits of science. And this is the divide which I believe we need to cross, and it's something that we need to address, because as time goes on, this divide is getting somewhat larger. There is an image that is built up in the minds of in media particularly, of the scientist in his laboratory or in her laboratory. And the typical scientist is thought of as somebody who is very interested in very small things. They're either completely genius types who are on the pedestal, or sometimes you think of them as mad scientists. And people, of course, make a lot of fun of them. This is not your typical scientist either. Actually, when you put them on a pedestal, then you give them Nobel Prizes, and then you think of them as either just brilliant, like this is this year's Nobel laureate Henderson on the left, or you think of them as absolutely geniuses who are also a little bit crazy. Closer to our times, this is also a genius of some kind, but she is also a PhD. This is a scientist, and many of you will recognize that this is Amy Farrah Fowler from The Big Bang Theory, who is a scientist on the sitcom, but is also a scientist in real life. So scientists come in all flavors. They come from the extremely nerdy, mad, crazy types, to the ones who do a variety of things. In particular, you can look like that, you can have a PhD in neuroscience, you can be in a sitcom, in a hit sitcom, and you can also have a life. How does one bridge this gap? Society, in particular our society, is a very scientifically alert and aware one. Regardless of what we hear in the media, there is this dichotomy about India, that this is a society which actually supports science and scientific progress. In fact, we are the only country who have written in our constitution the words that scientific temper is something that we should encourage amongst our people. And what scientific temper means in practical terms is that we apply the methods of science and scientific thought to almost anything that we do, within reason. And my talk really is today about this. How does one bridge the gap between the practice of science and its effects in society in as reasonable a manner as possible? The title of my talk was Talking About Science, and the subtitle said the importance of explaining, the importance of talking about science to your grandmother. The subtitle actually goes back to a quote by Einstein, who is reputed to have said that if you really understand something, you should be able to explain it to your grandmother. Now, this is, of course, something that you have to understand and interpret, because whatever Einstein said, there was some deep truths to it. But there are three aspects of this particular statement of Einstein's that I'd like to draw your attention to. Without wanting to cast aspersions on anybody's grandmother's level of education, this represents, of course, a little passage of time. So whatever one does, one should be able to talk to almost anybody and explain to them what is it that one does. The second part of this statement, at least as way I look at it, is that it's important to be honest about what you say. When you're a scientist or, in fact, any practitioner, when you talk about what you do, you are not going to lie to your grandma. So speak the truth. Tell really what's the result. What have you learned or what have you not learned? And the third thing is something that I'm more sensitive to in our country, particularly because many times our grandmothers speak other languages. So there's no point going back and saying, you know, I did this, that, or the other in English. You have to be able to speak in a language which people understand. So the statement of Einstein's, I see it in this particular way. You've got to be able to say things simply. You've got to be able to talk to anybody. And you've got to be honest about it. And virtually in any language. This is one of the most difficult things in India. We are not able to translate whatever it is that we do, particularly the science that we do. We are not able to take it and talk to everybody on an equal footing. Most often, when you start, especially when people, you know, try to say that I want to tell you about science, the reaction of most people is, please stay away from me. Either I don't know science, or I don't want to know about science, or maybe I don't really believe what you're saying. But one has to go over that. And human history has had a lot of different opportunities to talk about science. And today, the scene is a little different because we have social media, we have TV, all sorts of stuff where you can talk about what it is that you do. Many of the most important scientific discoveries in the past used to be communicated to the public by a series of public talks, rather like this one. In particular, Darwin's theory of evolution was explained to audiences all over the Western world, really by a lot of lectures that were to the ordinary public. Other famous scientists, Stephen Hawking, for example, they have written books which have become bestsellers. There was allusion to that this morning. So, one of the ways in which scientists have communicated their work to the public at large was through books or through actual lecturing. When I came back to the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research about 30-odd years ago, I was at that time working in an area which is nowadays known quite popularly as chaos theory. But when I came back, there were very few people who worked in that area, and I found myself invited to a lot of places to go and talk about it. And I generally found it to be a lot of fun because you got a chance to interact with a different audience. But then when you told them that you worked on chaos theory, the first thing was, oh my God, what is that? Then you say something like, you want to talk about the future, how do you predict the future? And half the audience would think that I was talking about astrology. And they said, oh no, we don't believe in astrology. And the other half actually thought I was going to predict their future for them, neither of which is true. But about the time that I was doing this, a very famous book came out. It's called Chaos, The Beginnings of a New Science. And this was a popular book which has sold several million copies. But this is the kind of exposition which is at the very forefront of science communication. It talks about great science, and it brings out the science to the people at large. Why is it so important to communicate science to every word. This is my basic thesis over here today, that it is important to be able to talk about the science that you do to everybody, even though there may be some aspects of it which are not comprehensible in the detail, but nevertheless, it's important to get the broad ideas across. There is actually only one reason. Science today is very expensive. Science today is very esoteric. So the society at large takes a small part of its resources and invests it in big science. When you invest a lot of money in science, this is money that belongs to the public, to the community. And that funds scientists working in their laboratories. It makes it possible for people to do very, very fancy experiments. You hear about the Higgs boson. A lot of money has gone into it. You hear about gravitational waves, huge amounts of money. Cures for cancer, or at least attempts to find cures for cancer, the Human Genome Project, you name it, no individual can afford it anymore. People have to be funded by society. And when that happens, it's very worthwhile to remember what some deep thinkers have said about this. This is Robert Oppenheimer, and after World War II, at the time when the atom bomb was exploded, he was in charge of that project, he had the following to say: we are firm in our belief in the value of science, and this is as true of India today as it was of America or anywhere else at any other point in time. We know what good that it can be to the world. We know that it can teach us about reality, about nature. But we cannot forget our dependence on our fellow men. It's not just a material dependence, that is, it's not just the money that society invests in people. It's also a moral dependence. And these are the deepest bonds that bind us to our fellow men. So today, any scientific advance is really made possible by the contributions, not just of a governmental decision, but they are made implicitly by the contributions of each one of us. And each one of us consumes science in a certain way. The lights, the cameras, whatever, the laptops, all these are the eventual productions of science and the scientific method. Some part of us as a society, are invested in doing science, and those are the scientists who are sitting on the one side. So we have, and maybe this audience is like a metaphor for this kind of divide, there is a group of us that as a community we have decided will be invested in science and be given the privilege. They have to fight for grants, they have to prove themselves, but they can go ahead and try to do the science for the rest of our society. All of us will benefit. All of us can benefit. All of us must debate, and we must find out how to benefit. There must be a rational approach to try to find out how the science that is developed in some laboratories can be used for the betterment of all of us. And in between, and this is one of the reasons I chose to speak at Jamia, because we have such a fine department of communication. In between is the group that is going to bridge these two sides, to bridge the divide, explain what the problems are, explain the limitations, explain the methodology, and in fact, we all need to be able to not just support science in a blind way, but also support it with intelligence and with rational thought. There are many in our society who have invested a lot of their time in doing that, because society being what it is, has this mixture of people who believe, do not believe, and so on and so forth. Today, more than ever, it is extremely important that we speak for science, and we need people who will speak with intelligent thought for science and its scientific methods, because ultimately, this is what benefits all of us. Thank you.